In this video, we'll be covering what every dentist should know when it comes to giving your patients the option of getting implants, how to deal with patients who present with implants and periimplantitis, and we'll finish off by discussing the different journeys a dentist can take to being able to provide implants for their patients. Hi everyone and welcome back. Today I am honored to be joined by the amazing award-winning dentist, Dr. Anushivaran Ariyakish, who is the director of the award-winning practice, White Rose Dental Studio. And he has over 25 years of clinical experience with a master's in periodontology and a special interest in the diagnosis and treatment of periimplantitis.
Thank you for having me. I think this is a topic that many people can benefit from and I look forward to sharing my knowledge.
We're going to be doing this in the form of a Q&A, so let's get started. My first question to you is, what are the advantages of replacing a gap with an implant?
Dental implants allow the missing tooth gap to be restored without any attachments to the adjacent teeth, therefore facilitating a more improved hygiene when compared to dental bridges or dentures. In addition, an appropriately placed dental implant leads to less bone loss in the missing tooth space when compared to dentures. Dental implants can be placed without any involvement with the surrounding teeth, eliminating the need for unnecessary tooth preparation immediate to the gaps. Implants are fixed titanium screws that face with the bone, hence they become permanent fixtures as long as their health is maintained.
So that sounds like a great option. Is there a minimum or a maximum age for getting implants?
There is no maximum age as long as the patient is fit and healthy and the surgical procedure is justifiable based on clinical guidelines. In terms of a minimum age, this is different for male and female patients. For a male patient, it is advisable not to place implants below the age of 22 or 23, and for the female patient, not below the age of 24 or 25, as the facial skeleton is still undergoing a growth process.
Okay, let's say a patient was a good candidate for an implant. How many sessions does it take to complete an implant treatment?
In general, we need 6 sessions. The first session is the initial consultation and case assessment based on patient's wishes and expectations. The assessment of the patient's suitability for implant treatment would be carried out and a detailed discussion about these risks and benefits of dental implant treatment and all available alternatives would take place. Impressions are then taken to manufacture models of the patient's upper and lower jaw for further planning and creation of a surgical guide. Patients are then referred internally or externally for CBCT imaging. The second session is about presenting the treatment plan to the patient, having a detailed discussion about clinicians' thoughts and patients' expectations and the final decision making. The third session is the surgical day when implants are placed. This is usually the longest appointment. The fourth session is a short review appointment at 1, 2, or 3 weeks after the surgery. This is to reassess the healing. The fifth and sixth sessions are generally 3 months after the surgical implant placement. This is when the clinician reassesses the implant and starts the process of crowning the implants. This phase normally takes between 2 to 4 weeks and is usually over 2 short appointments. So in general, 6 appointments, one of which is the 2-3 hours long surgical implant placement. Now, when you look at the detail of this implant treatment process, one would question the credibility of some adverts on newspapers claiming implants in one day, oversimplifying and somewhat misleading the patients.
Our next question is, how long does the healing process take after an implant surgery?
In general, patients feel well and do not have pain after the surgery. Full healing of the soft tissues or the implant takes between 4 to 6 weeks and it takes approximately 3 months for the implant itself to achieve a biological connection with the surrounding bone. And this process is called osseointegration.
And my next question is, which cases or scenarios are not suitable for an implant?
Those that are not suitable usually present with underlying medical conditions that exist at the time of implant treatment. Conditions like uncontrolled diabetes, unstable periodontitis, cancer treatment, radiation therapy to the jaw area, medication history such as bisphosphonates or chemotherapy, a recent heart attack, and that is just to name a few, but the clinician must take a full medical history and liaise with the patient's doctor. Also, contraindications to implant treatment include patients with poor oral hygiene and those who do not comply with oral hygiene instructions given by the clinician. Smoking is also a risk factor for implant health. Although smoking itself is not a contraindication for placement of dental implants, patients must be warned that they would be at higher risk of implant failure. Now, we know from literature that smoking and diabetes are risk factors for periodontitis. However, we do not yet have conclusive evidence to know whether these are also risk factors for periimplantitis. Presence or lack of sufficient space for implantation also is an issue. This needs to be fully assessed during clinical examination and measurements of the spaces by means of study models and help of CBCT scans. If you imagine that the diameter of an implant on average would be 4 millimeters, then that means that we need a space of almost 8 millimeters to be able to place one implant.
Now let's talk about a patient who presents to a general dentist with implants already. How should that general dentist assess those implants?
Well, we start with history taking and we should find out when the implants were placed as well as the full details about the implant, like the brand name, material and surface characteristics of the implant. Arrangements to obtain a previous radiograph is desirable and a good practice. We should ask the patients if they have any symptoms in relation to the implant. We then visually inspect the soft tissues around the implant for signs of inflammation such as red and swollen gingival margins. Further on, we should have two types of periodontal probes, plastic and metal, available to measure the peri-implant probing depths around the implant, which should not be more than 5 millimeters. At the same time, there should not be any bleeding on probing at 6 points around an implant.
And how do we deal with scaling around an implant?
Scaling around an implant should be performed with care, not to breach the tissue attachments to the neck of the implant on a healthy implant. For implants made of titanium, titanium hand scalers should be used. Systems using a mixture of air and abrasive particles have also been found effective. You should not be using your usual scalers made of stainless steel on a surface of an implant. In addition to that, the usual ultrasonic scalers should not be used on dental implants because they will cause surface damage and make implants more prone to periodontitis.
And when should we be referring a patient with an implant and who should we be referring to?
As soon as you detect a peri-implant probing depth of more than 5 millimeters and radiographic evidence of bone loss around an implant, a referral to periodontist for a second opinion and treatment planning is a wise approach. This is also extremely important from a medical-legal aspect. Later on, if this condition worsens or if indeed it stays the same, but a diagnosis of peri-implantitis is established by another colleague, you may find yourself responsible and criticized for failing to diagnose this important condition in addition to failing to treat it.
Okay, let's talk a bit about peri-implantitis. First of all, what is it?
Peri-implantitis is a bacterial inflammatory condition of the tissues surrounding a dental implant with loss of bone. It is important to note that in the presence of inflammation but absence of bone loss, we are talking about peri-implant mucositis, which precedes peri-implantitis. It is important to be able to differentiate between peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis. The latter is the same inflammation but with loss of bone.
Okay, and what can cause peri-implantitis?
There are different causes. This could be a patient's poor oral hygiene, incorrect placement of dental implant, poor design of the prosthetic aspect, such as the bridge or crown supported by the implant, pre-existing and unstable periodontal disease, and most commonly, it is a patient who is non-compliant with the implant maintenance regime, such as 3 monthly hygienist visits.
And how can we diagnose it?
So, clinically, the signs are peri-implant probing depths of 5 millimeters and more, in addition to bleeding on probing. Radiographically, we would compare the baseline radiographs with the current radiographs and look for bone loss. And in the absence of the baseline radiograph, we would look for bone loss of 3 millimeters or more to reach our diagnosis.
What are the symptoms of peri-implantitis?
Most patients will not complain of any symptoms. Occasionally, a patient might observe a suppuration, which is a discharge often white or yellow in color from the gingival margin surrounding an implant. In case of a mobile dental implant, a diagnosis of implant failure is definitive, in which case the implant must be removed as soon as possible.
And what are the outcomes of treatment of peri-implantitis?
Good question. This is something that experts are still talking about to reach a consensus. Obviously, the outcome is long-term survival of an osseointegrated implant. This is what we call an endpoint outcome. However, often we have to wait some years to find out about the outcomes of the treatment. In the case of dental implants, we need to look at surrogate outcomes, which are markers such as resolution of inflammation, such as marginal bleeding and reduction of the peri-implant probing depths. Radiographic bone fill of the implant bony defect is also a desirable outcome. But I must emphasize that clinicians must focus on patients' aesthetic expectations. To the clinician, reduction of the pocket depths and radiographic bone may be a successful treatment outcome. However, sight of a few millimeters of an implant metallic body above the gum level in the mouth may not necessarily meet a patient's expectations of a successful outcome. The aesthetic criteria is commonly missed by many clinicians.
And finally, the last question I have today is, what are the different routes that we can take to becoming an implant provider?
Now, this ranges from self-training by means of private mentorship arrangements with an experienced local mentor to participating in formal implant surgery training, such as postgraduate certificate and diploma courses that can lead to MSCs and other qualifications. You can also enroll on part-time or full-time MSC or MClinical periodontology programs available in various universities. Establishing a good professional relationship with a local mentor is of paramount importance. You will need a lot of support from case selection and early treatment planning to troubleshooting when things don't go in line with the treatment plan. It is very important to choose the right mentor. You need to meet them, you need to observe their work, you need to be comfortable with what they do. Placing thousands of implants, otherwise said titanium screws, in jawbones does not mean that someone is qualified enough to teach you how to place implants.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ariakesh, for answering all our questions with regards to implants and periimplantitis. If you guys found that useful, which I'm sure you did, you might also enjoy some of the other videos that we have on our channel, so feel free to check out some of the suggestions here.
If you guys have any other questions regarding implants, feel free to message me on Instagram at White Rose Dental Studio and I will get back to you. I would like to congratulate you guys for this innovative incentive in digital education.
Thank you so much, and thank you everyone for watching.
Thank you.